Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Justices Behind Roe v. Wade, the inside story adapted from The Brethren by Bob Woodward and Scott Armstrong. Read by Holter Graham.
To Catherine Graham, chairman of the board, the Washington Post Company, for her unwavering commitment to an independent press and the First Amendment. And to our children, Tolly, Thane, and Tracy. A court which is final and unreviewable needs more careful scrutiny than any other. Unreviewable power is the most likely to self-indulge itself, and the least likely to engage in dispassionate self-analysis. In a country like ours, no public institution or the people who operate it can be above public debate. Warren E. Berger, Circuit Court of Appeals Judge to Ohio Judicial Conference on September 4, 1968, 9 months before being named Chief Justice of the United States. Author's note. Two people labored as long and as hard on this book as the authors. Al Kamen, a former reporter for the Rocky Mountain News, assisted us in the reporting, writing, and editing of this book. He was the chief negotiator and buffer between us. His thoroughness, skepticism, and sense of fairness contributed immeasurably. No person has ever offered us as much intelligence, endurance, tact, patience, and friendship. Benjamin Weiser, now a reporter for the Washington Post, helped in the research, writing, editing, and reporting. A devoted and resourceful assistant, no one could have been more loyal and trusted. This book is as much theirs as ours. Introduction. The United States Supreme Court, the highest court in the land, is the final forum for appeal in the American judiciary. The court has interpreted the Constitution and has decided the country's preeminent legal disputes for nearly two centuries. Virtually every issue of significance in American society eventually arrives at the Supreme Court. Its decisions ultimately affect the rights and freedom of every citizen. Poor, rich, black people, Indian people, pregnant women, those accused of crime, those on death row, newspaper publishers, pornographers, environmentalists, businessmen, baseball players, prisoners, and presidents. For those nearly 200 years, the court has made its decisions in absolute secrecy, handing down its judgments in formal written opinions. The court's deliberative process, its internal debates, the tentative positions taken by the justices, the preliminary votes, the various drafts of written opinions, the negotiations, confrontations, and compromises, is hidden from public view. The court has developed certain traditions and rules, largely unwritten, that are designed to preserve the secrecy of its deliberations. The few previous attempts to describe the court's internal workings, biographies of particular justices or histories of individual cases, have been published years, often decades, after the events, or have reflected the viewpoints of only a few justices. Much of the history, notably the period that included the continued court-ordered desegregation of public schools, the Vietnam War, and the role of the states in regulating abortion, suggests that the detailed steps of decision-making, the often hidden motives of the decision-makers, can be as important as the eventual decisions themselves. Yet the court, unlike the Congress and the presidency, has by and large escaped public scrutiny. And because its members are not subject to periodic re-election but are appointed for life, the court is less disposed to allow its decision-making to become public. Little is usually known about the justices when they are appointed. and after taking office, they limit their public exposure to the court's published opinions and occasional, largely ceremonial, appearances. The Justices Behind Roe v. Wade is an account of the inner workings of the Supreme Court from 1969 to 1973, the first 4 years of Warren E. Burger's tenure as Chief Justice of the United States. However, it is not intended as a comprehensive review of all the important decisions made during the period. The court conducts its business during an annual session called a term, which begins each October and continues until the last opinion is announced in June or early July. The court recess runs from then until the next October. Normally, there are 7 decision-making steps in each case the court takes. 1. The decision to take the case requires that the court note its jurisdiction or formally grant cert. Under the court's procedures, the justices have discretion in selecting which cases they will consider. At least 4 of the 9 justices must vote to hear a case. These votes are cast in a secret conference, attended only by the justices, and the actual vote is ordinarily not disclosed. 2. Once the court agrees to hear a case, it is scheduled for written and oral argument by the lawyers for the opposing sides. The written arguments, called legal briefs, are filed with the court and are available to the public. The oral arguments are presented to the justices publicly in the courtroom. A half hour is usually allotted to each side. 3. A few days after oral arguments, the justices discuss the case at a closed meeting called the case conference. There is a preliminary discussion and an initial vote is taken. Like all appellate courts, the Supreme Court normally uses the facts already developed from testimony and information presented to the lower trial court. The Supreme Court can reinterpret the laws, the U.S. Constitution, and prior cases. On this basis, the decisions of lower courts are affirmed or reversed. As in the cert conference, at which justices decide which cases to hear, only the justices attend the case conferences. The 9 members of the court often refer to themselves collectively as the conference. 4. The next crucial step is the selection of one of the 9 justices to write a majority opinion. By tradition, the Chief Justice, if he is in the initial majority, can assign himself or another member of the majority to write the opinion. When he is not in the majority, the senior justice in the majority makes the assignment. 5. While one justice is writing the majority opinion, others may also be drafting a dissent or a separate concurrence. It can be months before these opinions, a majority, dissent, or concurrence, are sent out or circulated to the other justices. In some cases, the majority opinion goes through dozens of drafts, as both the opinion and the reasoning may be changed to accommodate other members of a potential majority or to win over wavering justices. As the justices read the drafts, they may shift their votes from one opinion to another. On some occasions, what had initially appeared to be a majority vanishes, and a dissenting opinion picks up enough votes to become the tentative majority opinion of the court. 6. In the next to last stage, the justices join a majority or a dissenting opinion. Justices often view the timing, the sequence, and the explanations offered for joins as crucial to their efforts to put together and hold a majority. 7. In announcing and publishing the final opinion, the justices choose how much of their reasoning to make public. Only the final versions of these opinions are available in law libraries. The published majority opinion provides the legal precedents which guide future decisions by lower courts and the Supreme Court itself. We began this project in the summer of 1977 as 2 laymen lacking a comprehensive knowledge of the law. We read as many of the cases and as much of the background material about the period as time would allow. We found the work of Derek Bell, Paul Brest, Lyle Denniston, Fred Graham, Eugene Gressman, Gerald Gunther, Richard Kluger, Nathan Lewin, Anthony Lewis, John McKenzie, Michael Meltzner, John Nowak, Ronald Rotunda, Nina Totenberg, and Lawrence Tribe, particularly helpful. We thank them and countless others on whose writings we have drawn. Most of the information in this book is based on interviews with more than 200 people, including several justices, more than 170 former law clerks, and several dozen former employees of the court. Chief Justice Warren E. Burger declined to assist us in any way. Virtually all the interviews were conducted on background, meaning that the identity of the source will be kept confidential. This assurance of confidentiality to our sources was necessary to secure their cooperation. The sources who helped us were persons of remarkable intelligence. They had unusually precise recall about the handling of cases that came before the court, particularly the important ones. However, the core documentation for this book came from unpublished material that was made available to us by dozens of sources who had access to the documents. We obtained internal memoranda between justices, letters, notes taken at conference, case assignment sheets, diaries, unpublished drafts of opinions, and in several instances, drafts that were never circulated even to the other justices. By the time we had concluded our research, we had filled 8 file drawers with thousands of pages of documents from the chambers of the 11 justices who served during the period 1969 to 1973. For each of the 4 terms we describe, we had at least 1, usually 2, and often 3 or 4 reliable sources in each justice's chamber, in no case fewer than 20 sources per term. Where documents are quoted, we have had direct access to the originals or to copies. We have attributed thoughts, feelings, conclusions, predispositions, and motivations to each of the justices. This information comes from the justices themselves, their diaries or memoranda, their statements to clerks or colleagues, or their positions as regularly enunciated in their published court opinions. No characterization of a justice could be comprehensive, but we believe those that are provided.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.